the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning brings eternal bright and fair. When the sailors shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Oh, that bright and glorious morning when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home behind the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
From Brother Burt this morning said that they had made it in, and I think they had to dodge the weather yesterday over there. You know, they had some tornadoes in Louisiana, Mississippi, and, but they made it in safely, and so they're at home this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day and for this time and opportunity to come and offer our petitions to you, Lord. You've been good to us this past week. We've had revival the first of the week, Lord, and you bless Brother Burt, and give him some messages, Lord, that brought, Lord, that dealt with each one of us. Lord, we need to take and apply them to our lives and meditate on them, Lord, what the Word had to say to us. We had know we were having several revivals countywide. A lot of churches over the county were in revival, so Lord, we pray that the churches, other churches, was also lifted up, Lord, and thankful and grateful to a wonderful and mighty Savior. Lord, we know that we worship a God that has all power in heaven and earth, and Lord can do all things, and all you got to do is just speak, Lord, and things can happen. We thank you so much for a God of this stature and a God who loves us, shares with us his grace and mercy. We thank you, Lord, for that. We ask you to bless this service today, Lord, here at Antioch. We ask you to bless Brother Hans as he comes, Lord, and preaches your word, and our associational missionary. And we just thank you, Lord, for being the director of missions. And we pray that you'd bless him, not only here today in the service, but, Lord, through his work. Lord, you may give him insight and give him ideas and things, Lord, to lead the association in a proper and a good way. And Lord, that we would exalt you, Lord, through the Mallard Baptist Association, and lift your name up. We pray for Alina and her tour or trip that she's going on. We pray for thy blessing to be with her and the group that she's going with, and know they're looking forward to it, and just give them safety and thy blessing to be upon them. Lord, we ask you to bless our pastor this morning, Lord, as he's had surgery. We pray that you would just be with him and, Lord, get him well soon and let him be up and about. And we thank you for him, and we ask you to bless the others, Lord. Miss Patty Redfield, Lord, has had surgery also. We pray that she's doing well and she'll get home safely. We ask you now just bless the others in our membership and on our prayer list, Lord, that are ailing or sick or afflicting in any way, and maybe personal problems or whatever, we just ask thy blessing be upon them and help them, Lord, to do, Lord, is what they need to do. And Lord, you just let you know that you're there with them to help them through these trying times. Now forgive us when we fail you, Lord, so many times, and help us, Lord, as a person and as a group, as a church, Lord, a group of baptized believers, to move forward and, Lord, lift this community up and be willing to help in any way we possibly can. And these things, Lord, we ask in your precious and holy name. Amen.
I want to. All right. So, I decided to talk about change. We all experienced a change last night to this morning. What happened from last night to this morning? We lost something. The time changed. We lost an hour. Yes. So, unless you went to bed early. Did any of you go to bed early? No, we didn't either. We all experienced, that's something we all experienced. We lost our hour of sleep, and we'll all be feeling it about 3 o'clock this afternoon. But that's okay. We all survived, didn't we? Did we survive it? All right, Bailey doesn't look like she survived. But we survived it, though. Did you know we all experience changes? Sometimes it's something like that. We all experience that. Sometimes maybe it's something only you experience. Sometimes change is fun. Sometimes it's not very fun. Sometimes it's easy, and sometimes it's hard. Sometimes we want change to come, and sometimes we go, why did it come? But it doesn't really matter. Things are always changing. Things are always changing. And so I found this thing because, you know what? Even though things change, guess who doesn't change? Who's that again?
God.
God never changes. Our situation may always change, but God never changes. And there's a memory verse. It's from Malachi chapter 3, verse 6. And it tells us that God said, "For I am the Lord, I change not." So the Bible tells us that God never changes. And if God never changes, that means He's, even though we change, but God's always with us, He's right there taking care of us. So I found a way, that's right, He's in our heart. I found this acronym. That's a really big word for saying it gives us a word for every letter in the word changes. And it helps us remember that God is with us or that Jesus is with us. So changes is spelled C-H-A-N-G-E-S. And it says, our acronym is Christ has a new gift each second. Because changes can happen just that quick. A change can happen in a matter of a moment. But even in that moment, God is there and He has a new gift for that. So can y'all listen, y'all reckon y'all can remember that? Christ has a new gift each second. He's got a new blessing for you in every change that comes your way. And each change or moment holds a blessing or a gift from God. So when those changes happen, are we going to be scared? No. Are we always going to be happy about it? Well, we should be, but we're not. We're not always going to be happy about change. But what we're going to remember is who is with us.
God.
God's with us. And even when He walks with us all the time, and even though things around us change, who doesn't change? God. So have faith. Those bad situations and those strange situations and things like that, even though they may seem bad or strange, it could be God's way of sending a really good blessing your way. Okay? All right, so let's pray. Dear Lord, we all experience changes. And we know that in this life, sometimes we're on ups and then we're on downs. And sometimes it happens in just a matter of seconds. But dear Lord, we know that with every second we have You, that You never change, and that we can have faith that You're with us, and staying with us and taking care of us on the easy things and the hard things, on the happy and the sad. We love You, dear Lord, and we pray that You'll be with us as we deal with our changes each and every day. Amen. All right, come on up here.
right, off to our hymn number 730. Stand up for Jesus. You can't sit down, so stand up. What do I need? I need offering taker uppers. Look, just because Bruce ain't here. Josh, will you lead us in prayer?
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you today and thank you for our blessings, Lord. We just thank you for allowing us to come here and worship you, Father, and just be able to hear the word that you have to say to us, Lord. We just pray for Brother Hans as he is the vessel that brings us, Father, just let him say what you want to say and let us hear what you want us to hear. Thank you for that opportunity, Father. Father, we pray now for our country, Lord. We pray for the president. We ask you that you hide him behind the cross, Father. We just ask that you just continue to lead this country in the way that you want us to go, Father, and help us to see that and follow you, Lord. Father, we pray for the men and women at home and abroad, our missionaries and our troops, Father. Just cover them with your grace and mercy, Lord. And since you be with this church, help us do it so on what your will may be. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you. Lots to be excited about this morning, huh?
Amen.
Amen. God is good. Appreciate your prayers for your pastor. And just to let you know, my wife got a three-day head start on him. She also had her knee replaced, different knee, but same doctor, on Tuesday. So while you're praying for Brother Bruce, if you think about it, pray for Miss Laurie. And we will be very, very grateful. And so neat to hear about Miss Lena and her trip to Uganda. I checked my cell phone real quick because I've got a dear friend in that neck of the woods, but she's in Kenya, which is one country over, and not in Uganda. But she flies into Uganda in order to get to Kenya. So anyway, that's really exciting. Really exciting for your church. And it's just neat to see how God is moving in the lives of our young people, our median age adults, our senior adults, and carrying his word around the world. That's exciting. It's exciting to me. So glad to be your associational missionary. I see some new faces since the last time I've been here, so nice to meet you, and hope we get to visit with each other a little bit more over the next couple of weeks. Do you know what season we're in right now? You know what's coming up? What's the next big holiday coming up? No, St. Patrick's Day. No, that's right. Easter. Easter's the next big one coming up. And we're in that time right before Easter, 40 days. And, you know, 40 days is a biblically significant number, right? And so there's a lot of our brothers and sisters in Christ who are in other denominations who celebrate something called Lent. And it's the Easter season, right? Now, I'm not going to get into a whole lot about Lent, but I do want us to talk a little bit about why we know Jesus is the Messiah, okay? Why we know Jesus is the Messiah over the next couple of weeks. So I encourage you to be back tonight. We're going to be on the same subject, different passage, and then next week as well. So I remember it kind of like it was yesterday, although it was nearly 20 years ago, the day that we went to find out that our first child was a boy or a girl, right? We went for an ultrasound. My wife was pregnant with our oldest son, Micaiah, and it was about this time of year, and we were living in Lynchburg, Virginia, and there was snow on the ground, right? There was snow on the ground, and you know what? We were a little bit nervous about going to our appointment across town and fighting that snow, because even though we were in Virginia, they still don't know how to drive in snow, okay? So yeah, they'll pick on you, but it doesn't get any better when you get into Virginia, okay? So maybe New York, I don't know, but definitely not Virginia. And so in those days, we still have these things called, these old things, kids, called VCRs, video cassette recorders. That was our DVD. Actually, that was before DVD, and even now, DVDs are gone. That was our MP4 of the day, right? That was way before, and we had these things called video cassettes, and they're huge. You might find some in your church library. They were huge things, and you would put them in this machine, and they would play a video, okay? And so what they would do when you go to the ultrasound is, if you wanted to, you could bring a blank video cassette, and they would record the ultrasound for you. Anybody in here remember these days? Am I the only one? Amen. All right, good. So we're on the we're at the ultrasound, and we've got the videotape in hand, and I've got the videotape in one hand. I've got my wife's hand in the other, and we're nervous. Laurie was nervous and pregnant, so that was a little bit more than me just being nervous. And we waited what seemed like an eternity, although it was probably just a few minutes. I mean, it wasn't even an hour, because we were excited to find out that our baby was healthy. We were excited to find out that our baby had, you know, all the things that he was supposed to have, and we were excited to find out whether or not we were having a boy or a girl, because, you know, we were ready to start painting this nursery, right? We were ready to start getting on with this, all right? So, but I already knew, long before the ultrasound, I knew that our first child would be a boy. How did I know, you ask? Well, that's a very good question. You see, my grandfather was the firstborn in his family, and obviously he was a boy. My father was the firstborn in his family of four, and he was a boy. And I was an only child, or still am an only child. And I obviously am male as well. So I told my wife, long before we even got married, that our first child would be a boy, and that he'd be born on the 19th of some month. Now, the funny thing about that is that my wife was induced on the 19th of June, but my son didn't show up till the 21st. So, you know, but we got really close. Hey, got really, really close. So, anyway, so we go into this room, and Laurie climbs up onto this table, and they dim the lights, and the nurse fires up this machine. And you have to understand, this machine is a lot nicer, not near as nice as what we have at the Worth County Alpha Pregnancy Center, okay? This is an older machine, big black and white monitor. It looked like a small version of Pac-Man, right? It's got a joystick. It's got this wand, it's got this keyboard, and all these things going on. And so they dim the lights, and the nurse exposes my wife's belly, and she pulls out this wand. Now, it's not a thin, like, magic wand, but it is magic nonetheless. And so she squirts this stuff all over it. Looks like a ketchup bottle, but it was clear. And squirts this stuff all over it, and then starts rubbing it around my wife's belly. And I'm like, what is going on here? And then on this little black and white screen, a picture starts to arrive, right? This picture of our child. And so now the nurse says, oh, look, there's a kidney. And I'm like, yeah. I have no idea. Sure. Okay. And she keeps moving. Look, toes. I see five toes. That's good. A leg. She keeps moving and highlighting different parts. I used to put like a little circle around them and everything and take these snapshots. And friends, it's not nearly as clear as the nice 3D ultrasounds that we have today. Like, you can see the kid's face. You're like, wow, it's got grandma's eyes. I mean, you know, nothing like that in those days. All right. But much of what we saw that day, we had to take the nurse's word for, right? I mean, when she said that was a kidney, I'm going to believe you, that was a kidney. And that's the baby's head, I could see that, all right? And we used to joke and say that, you know, that the ultrasound techs, they trained for that job while trying to watch movies on HBO when they didn't actually get HBO, right? You know, remember the cable in the old days was all fuzzy and everything? Yeah, that's what we joked about. But anyway, kids, you wouldn't understand what I'm talking about because you've got YouTube and all that stuff. But technology, even in those days, was a wonderful thing. But knowing things about a child before he is born or before she is born, it's hardly a new thing. It's amazing, as an ultrasound is, the Bible records things about Jesus before he was even conceived, before his parents were conceived. More than just an angel telling Mary and Joseph they're going to have a son and name him Jesus, but years before, right? Decades, hundreds of years before. For instance, the passage we're going to look at this morning was written roughly 500 years before Jesus' birth. Wow, that's amazing, isn't it? Half a millennia before the birth of Christ. And so this morning we're going to embark on a journey where we look at pictures of Jesus, but not so much pictures about before he's being born or after he's born, but way before, right? In an effort for us to know during this Easter season that Jesus is the promised Messiah. In our passage this morning, we find ourselves looking at a vision that Zechariah had of the high priest of his day. And if you want to go ahead and start to find the book of Zechariah in the Old Testament, which is kind of, for me, hard to find because I didn't grow up in Scripture and didn't learn all the books of the Bible in order and all those things. So if you want to go ahead and start digging for Zechariah while I'm talking, that's totally fine. But we're going to be in Zechariah chapter 3. And Israel had returned from Babylon to the Promised Land, and Jerusalem was in the process of being rebuilt. And in this vision, Joshua, the high priest, is standing on trial. He's on trial before the Lord and everybody else, and he's being judged by the angel of the Lord. And many theologians believe him to be a Christophany, or a picture, a vision of Christ before he is born. And who is accusing Joshua, the high priest? None other than the great accuser, Satan himself. And the people represented by the high priest are not where they need to be spiritually speaking. They are low. They are stained by sin. Their faith has atrophied by their inability to exercise it properly because they've been in exile for so many years, right? And so because they were not able to join together in worship of the Lord. And from the way the first five verses of chapter 3 read, it would not surprise me if Joshua thought that he was the worst high priest of all time, incapable of doing anything that would honor the Lord. But even though he's being accused by the devil himself, the judge, the angel of the Lord, the pre-incarnate Christ, commands that the priest's iniquity be removed and that he be deemed pure in the sight of the Lord. And once that happens, we begin reading in Zechariah chapter 3, verse 6. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for Antioch Baptist Church. Thank you for her people. Thank you for this congregation. And thank you for this place that we can gather together where we can worship you. But more than that, Lord, thank you that we don't cease being the church when we leave this place. Thank you for Pastor Bruce, and thank you for his spiritual leadership, all the leadership here at Antioch over the past few years. And we pray, God, for his swift recovery and for Larry's as well. Now, Lord, guide us and direct us in your word. Open our eyes that we may see the picture of Christ in this passage. In Christ's name we humbly pray. Amen. Zechariah chapter 3, starting in verse 6. And the angel of the Lord admonished Joshua, saying, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways, if you will keep my command, then you shall judge my house, and likewise have charge of my courts, and I will give you places to walk among those who stand here. Oh, hear, Joshua the high priest, you and your companions who sit before you, for they are a wondrous sign. For behold, I am bringing forth my servant, the branch. For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon the stone are seven eyes. Behold, I will engrave its inscription, says the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of the land in one day. In that day, says the Lord of hosts, everyone will invite his neighbor under his vine and under his fig tree." Now that Joshua has been made clean, Jesus admonishes him to do certain things. And in the process of this picture, one of three pictures of the Messiah will appear. Picture number one is the picture of the priest. The angel of the Lord says, "Walk in my ways, keep my command, and then you shall judge my house and have charge of my courts." Now, walk in my ways means having a personal relationship with Christ. You know, as I was on my way over here today, I was praying for my youngest son. He's 14 years old, and he's growing in the Lord. And I was just praying that, you know, that his faith would become his, that he wouldn't live on my faith, but that he would live on his own faith, that God would speak to him personally, that that relationship with him would grow. And it's exciting to me as he's just walking around and doing stuff day by day, and every now and then you'll just hear him break out in a hymn or break out in a Christian song. And that's just really exciting. But in order for a priest to be ready to serve the Lord, he must personally be following the Lord. Doesn't that make sense? Doesn't that just make sense that in order for somebody to get up and proclaim the word of the Lord and do the things of God, that they personally need to have a relationship with the Lord? It's not enough for a priest or a pastor or even a believer to simply say, "Do these things," or and not do these things themselves. In other words, do as I say, not as I do. Not good enough here, okay? It's just not good enough. And so, in fact, we even have a word for that, right? If somebody tells you to do as I say and not as I do, what is that word? Hypocrite. That's exactly right. We don't want to be a hypocrite. And so the priest in those days and the pastor, even the Christian in our day, is called to walk in the ways of God. Friends, that's a hard thing, isn't it? To walk in the ways of the Lord. It's not easy, and sometimes it's really not fun. But I'll be honest with you, it's the best way. It's the perfect way. It might be scary from time to time, but it's the best thing. But there's more. You see, there's the personal aspect, and then there's a corporate aspect, a group aspect. He says to keep my command, and that's the duties as a priest. And then there were things that a priest was called to do. And chief among them is keep the things of God before the people and maintain the worship of the Lord. You know why I'm here this morning? Because your pastor's not. right? I'm here because your pastor's not here. And he wanted to make sure that you heard a word from the Lord. And so he said, hey, I've got this surgery coming up. Hans, can you come and fill the pulpit this Sunday morning? And I said, certainly, I'll be more than happy to. It's his job to make sure somebody's here proclaiming the word before you, right? And in the day that we're talking about is Zechariah's day, it was the priest's job to make sure that people heard the word of the Lord. And we Christians, not just pastors, but Christians, are called to encourage others to follow the Lord. And the Lord goes on to say, then you will be able to judge my house and have charge of my courts. Now, while these first two things were two steps to do this, and then you can do that, these next two things, my house and my courts, are two sides of the same coin. There's a fellow by the name of Klein. He said, ultimately, Joshua's high priestly position points to Jesus Christ, the faithful high priest, who mediates and intercedes for the people of God with perfection and finality. And this one picture of the Messiah here in this passage, and you may be wondering, well, why so is that so important? Because even in Zechariah's day, the people were looking for a military Messiah. You see, they thought their problems were military problems. They were occupied by other people. They had been taken captive by other groups, by other nations. And they figured, as the Lord's chosen people, they had the spiritual side taken care of. Besides, in their mind, like I said, their problem was physical. The people had invaded our land. They were burning our crops. They were taking our women and children. They were physical problems, and they needed to be solved by a military leader. Besides, if you look at the book of Judges, that's all you see is military leaders, right? I mean, Gideon and Samson and Jephthah and all those folks, Deborah, all of them were military leaders. Physical problems solved by military leaders, what the people thought. Yet God was indicating all these years before he was going to send a spiritual Messiah that this is the picture. You need a great priest. Verse 8 says, hear, O Joshua the high priest, you and your companions who sit before you, for they are a wondrous sign. They will be a sign for the one to come, but greater than they are this. For he will be the one who follows the letter of the law perfectly, one without sin. And we know who that person is, right? That person is Jesus. And if you look at the New Testament, you find him being described as such. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14, we read, seeing that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. And so here's one picture, the priest. But there are two more pictures. Picture number two, found in verse 8, is, for behold, I'm bringing forth my servant, the branch. Now, this second picture, and if you study the Old Testament and New Testament, you will find the people of God being referred to in this way. Why? Because, well, let me ask you a question. How do we typically depict our families? If we were to draw a picture of our family, like all the way back to our great-great-great-great-grandparents, what would that look like? A tree, right? A family tree. And what do trees have? Branches, right? See, this is not rocket science, folks, right? And so he says that all of Israel comes from who? Jacob. And Jacob comes from Isaac, and Isaac comes from Abraham. And Abraham was the one that God made a covenant with and saying, hey, I'm going to bring many nations out of you, right? But this is the branch. This is the people of God. And God is showing another picture of the Messiah, that he's going to, that the Messiah would be one of his chosen people. He's not coming from outside the nation of Israel. He's coming up from inside. He's going to be a Jew, and his lineage would be traceable back in time to Abraham. And what do we find in Matthew chapter 1 and Luke chapter 2? We see that Jesus' lineage goes all the way back to Abraham and even beyond. And so they indeed were not looking for a Messiah from outside their race. And so while Alexander the Great may very well be great, he's not their Messiah, right? And Genghis Khan may be a great leader, but he's not their Messiah. And the Babylonians, who were very nice to send the Jews back to their land, and they were very kind to do so, they gave them the resources in which they could rebuild Jerusalem. That was nice too, but they're not the Messiah. Their leader wasn't the Messiah. Jesus would declare in John chapter 15, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. And all the branches, Jesus would go on to say, are found in me. They're connected to me. And if you're not connected to me, what? You're worthless. He says, if you abide in me and I abide in you, you're going to bear much fruit. But if I'm disconnected from you and you're disconnected from me, you're good for nothing except to be thrown in the fire and to be burned. Jesus declares that he is where it all comes from. Without him, there is no Israel. Without him, there is no salvation, no restoration of the relationship between God and man. And so our first picture is the picture of the priest. Our second picture is the picture of a branch. Lastly, the final picture is the picture of a stone. Look at verse 9. For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon the stone are seven eyes. Behold, I will engrave its inscription, says the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. The final picture of the Messiah from this passage is that of a stone. And some will question and say, well, what are these eyes on the stone? That's kind of weird, right? Well, we don't know if they mean because they see in all directions or if they're just facets, you know, like a gemstone would have seven or six facets or more or whatever. We're not really certain. But what we do know is this. This stone has a special engraving on it from the Lord, right? This stone has a message from the Lord. And the message is the removal of iniquity, the removal of sin. In Matthew chapter 21, starting verse 2, we read, Jesus said to them, have you ever read in the scriptures, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone? This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The builders rejected the stone at first. The builders said, well, that's really not what we're looking for. We're not really looking for that stone. In other words, the stone that was key to the foundation of the building, they said, nah, that's really not good. But do you understand what a cornerstone is? It was a stone you laid first, and all the other stones were built off of that one stone. All of the other ones had to be level with that and plumb with that one stone. If that stone is off, the entire building is off, right? It is the standard by which the entire building is built. All other stones are placed in relation to that one, and it's the most important foundation that there is. And it wasn't man's doing, Jesus declares, it was the Lord's doing. God picked this stone out. Now, I don't know about you, but it's pretty amazing to me that God sent pictures of the Messiah to the people years, decades, centuries before Jesus arrives on the scene, so that we would know, that we would know who Jesus was before he was. But guess what? The pictures didn't end with the prophets. And the pictures that pointed the ancients to Christ didn't end with the prophets, and those pictures didn't end with Jesus either. They were fulfilled in Christ, but they did not end with Christ. No, just like a proud parent or a proud grandparent, we carry those pictures with us today, everywhere we go. Paul challenges us, right, in Philippians chapter 1, only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Jesus himself said, if you love me, keep my commands. My oldest son that I was talking about earlier, I'm the oldest child on both sides of my family. And so Micaiah was the first grandchild on both sides of the family, right? My grandmother, my mom's mom, was so proud. Have you met those grandmas that are really proud of their grandkids? Maybe you're one of them. You don't have to point, okay? But you know who I'm talking about, right? And if you sat next to my grandmother, she was not an introvert, right? She was not an introvert. If she was in the line at the bank and you were with her, or if you were in the line at the store and you were with her, or if you were sitting next to her in Sunday school, or you were in the waiting room at the doctor, she would. And I've seen her do this on multiple occasions. To complete strangers, she would reach in her pocketbook or she would reach in her pocket and she would take out a picture of my oldest son and her grandson out of her purse, wherever she kept it that day, and she would always have that picture with her and she would show off to a total stranger, that's my grandbaby right there. That's my grandchildren, right? That's my grandson. She was so proud of him. But not just my son. She's proud of all of the grandkids. And proud of me. If I had a nickel for every time I walked in the room when she was in the hospital right before she passed away and said, there's my grandson. My son was her great-grand. See how bad I am at this? Okay. My son was her great-grand. She would point to me and she goes, that's my grandson. He's a Baptist preacher. Right? She pointed out, he's a Baptist preacher. And she would make sure everybody know who I was. And I have a cousin. It's funny because she's the youngest of my cousins, but she's actually younger than my son, who's the oldest great-grand. So she's the youngest grand. My son's the oldest. Anyway, it's confusing, isn't it? All right. But she's in the pageant scene, right? You know, where they get all gussied up and everything, and they walk across stage or play piano or dance or whatever they do. And she had a photo shoot that was in a magazine. And so my grandmother kept that magazine with her at the end of her life. And everyone she met, she says, you see, this is my granddaughter right here. This is my granddaughter. And that's my grandson. And that's my great-grandson. Man, she loved her family. And she pointed out pictures to everyone she meet. Everyone that she met. And you know what? We can do the same thing with Jesus. We can do the exact same thing with Christ. We can share the love of Christ with people. And in so doing, we'll be pulling out our own pictures of Jesus, saying, this is my Jesus. This is my Savior. When I am low, He is there. And when I'm on a mountaintop, He is there. And He's with me too. And there's no place that I can go and He's not already there. I mean, I can fly halfway across the world to Uganda, and Jesus is there. And I can come to Southwest Georgia, and Jesus is there. And I can go to Washington, D.C., and He may be hard to find, but He's there. He is there. He is my God. And you know what? My God doesn't sit on a shelf just waiting for me to take and dust Him off and pray to Him. No, He is constantly acting, and He's not off in some far country. And He's a God who loves it when I have faith in Him and I obey Him. He's a God who has tasked me and asked me and you and every believer in Jesus Christ to share the good news of Jesus Christ, to show those pictures to the people that we meet, to show Jesus Christ in our own lives. And now we are pictures of Christ, and we may be the only Jesus that somebody ever sees in their entire life. And it's hard to believe, right here in Georgia, in the buckle of the Bible Belt, but 80% of the people that you come in contact with do not go to church, do not believe Jesus Christ is the Savior. They don't believe these things. And you know why? Because we're not doing a really great job of showing our pictures. We're not. And He's called us to do that. And we have to make up our minds what kind of picture we're going to be. Are we going to be a clear picture? Are we going to be a fuzzy picture? Are we going to be a candid picture? Or are we going to be a stage picture? What kind of picture are we going to be? I just had to clean out my mom's house because she passed away in October. My mom was a pack rat. Saying a lot of things. We won't get into all that. But one of the things that I came home with, because that was imparted to me, I was told, I was, it would be in me, the picture.
being your Savior. So this morning, if you've never trusted Jesus, I would love the opportunity to share that with you today. Or maybe this is where God has called you to serve Him right here at Antioch Baptist Church. He wants you to serve Him here. If that's you this morning, you come. Or maybe this morning you just need to come and pray this altar and pray in your seat about something that God is doing in your life. Man, that's really nothing to do with what I've been talking about. I want you to hear one more. We heard an exciting testimony this morning about a young lady who the entire, for as long as she can remember, she feels called to go to Africa. Friends, God is still calling people in the ministry. Maybe He's calling you. Maybe He's calling somebody else in this church to be His minister, to be His missionary. Would you pray for those people today? Would you ask God His need? Let's give this time over to the Lord. And as we pray, and then we'll stand and sing our hymn of invitation. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for today. Thank you for these good folks. And thank you that we can be a picture of Jesus Christ in our own life. Lord, help us to be a good picture. Help us to be a picture that's not fuzzy, but clear. Help us to be a picture that's not fake, but candid. And every time people see us and come in contact with us, they see the love of Jesus Christ. They see the heart of Christ in everything that we do and everything we say and the ways we act and how we're at the ball games and how we're at school and how we're at work and all these different things. God, would you speak to our hearts? And Lord, if there is someone here today who doesn't know you as Savior and Lord, I pray, God, today you would speak to their heart. Lord, be with those who also need to make decisions. And also, Father, we pray especially for those that you're calling into ministry. Maybe there's someone here today you're calling into ministry. Lord, help them to realize your calling and to respond to it even today. We pray all these things in the matchless, the wonderful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. If you stand up, please receive your hymn of invitation. And you respond as the Lord leads.
697, The Way of the Cross Leads Home.